Good morning.
Ladies and gentlemen, and all the special guests behind me, I appreciate you all being here because there's some pending legislation which you fellows in this room on this side of the line consider to be devastating for those who are involved in a catastrophic accident. Public, in their wisdom, back in the 70s, passed legislation which we now know as auto no fault. And the legislature that came along in 1992 and said, hey, we're going to change it, put it to a vote of the people. 63% said, no, leave the way it is. And they came back in 94. Maybe you didn't understand what we were offering you. We'll give you a chance to reform, that third word, reform, auto no fault. And about 61% said, leave it alone. So twice the legislature has gone to the public and asked them to reform. Again, their word, auto no fault, place had been seriously rebuffed by two-thirds of the voting public. So this time they didn't bother asking the public. They just processed and passed some legislation that will dramatically and drastically impact innocent people who have been involved in catastrophic accidents. This is an industry, this is insurance industry's dream. I've been reading every analysis I can get my hands on since this so-called substitute bill was first introduced a couple weeks ago by Speaker Bolger. And every one of them says that the insurance industry is laughing their way to the bank. This is a pro-insurance industry, anti-victim piece of legislation, and it's as harsh as I can make it. And just it's most unfortunate that Speaker Bolger has made this his legislative goal for this term, because there are so many, hidden fish hooks in this legislation that I don't have time this morning to go through half of them. But I'll give you the highlights of why we're so vehemently opposed. And then I'll introduce my colleagues from Wayne and Macomb, and then the speaker, State Representative Tommy Stalwart, who's the head of the Michigan Black Caucus, will be here to speak on behalf of the city of Detroit. So I think you see some unanimity in our opposition here. And that I would introduce you to the other guests behind me. I got to make it clear from the onset that my accident was like 18 months ago, and my driver, Jim, is still paralyzed from the neck down. Will be a blocker for the rest of his life. We don't get a dime from the auto no fault fund, just so you know that. We were on duty when we were hit. Therefore, we're over here being covered, our expenses being covered by workers' compensation. So I'm not here to protect my revenue stream. Please understand that. There's a substitute bill. The first bill was 4612, House Bill 4612. And that was just utterly disastrous. I think it capped the injuries at $1 million. My driver, remember my accident was 18 months ago. My driver, Jimmy, even though we're not under this fund, he gives me a way to gauge it. It's already gone through $3 million, and now looking at $4 million in expenses. So giving us $1 million cap was illusory at best. It was just it looked good to the public. $1 million is a lot of money. But when you're being, if you recover from an accident like Jim and I sustained, and like Garrett sustained, $1 million is basically round one of a long struggle to try to regain some physical strength back. Things that I find most distasteful about this legislation, or not even in the press release. I mean, things like, how about the fact that the Catastrophic Claims Association, the ones that are administering this 17-point-something-billion-dollar fund, uses Cayman bank accounts that we can't get to, we can't examine. We say, well, why? And they say, well, we're under no duty to disclose. And then they come along and raise the rates from auto no fault from 179 this year to 186. So, well, what justified raising it to $7? So that's based on our actuarial assumptions. Well, let us see your actuarial assumptions. Let us judge if it was required, if it was even reasonable. No, we can't show you those. They're so complicated you wouldn't understand them. So they operate in secrecy. They operate offshore when they choose to. We're talking about $17 billion. And one of the reasons they raised the rate is because the fund was not sustainable, but it's growing. When I first got into this fight a couple of years ago, it was $14 billion. Now it's $17 billion. The fund is sustainable, and we don't have to try to make corrections and frankly, were written by the insurance industry. This is an insurance industry draft, pure and simple. And why Bolger is so insistent on promoting it, you have to ask yourself that question when everybody's lining up against it. The House representatives, they can't even get it out of his own committees in the House. Republicans and Democrats alike have smelled a rat on this one. And I think I know what it's all about. Mr. Bolger is term limited, and he's out of office in about 8 months. When's he going to get a job? I'm challenging him to answer this question. Are you going to work for the auto industry, for the insurance industry? Or are you going to work for a lobbying firm that represents insurance industries? If he says no, I'll accept his answer. But he's been asked that question 4 or 5 times, and he won't answer. So I think that's what it's all about. It's a little bit of doing a favor for the insurance industry in the hopes of landing a job when he's out of office. Some of the problems with the current piece of legislation, there's still going to be a cap on recovery. That the first bill was $1 million. Now they're kicking it up to 10. 10 sounds like a lot, and it is a lot. But we know people who have gone through 10 already. A little 5-year-old girl, for instance, that I'm sure some of our guests here can address better than I, who 10 million is not even begin to cover her expenses and her recovery. So there's still a cap in here. The public, that's one of the issues that the public voted on back in 1994, said, no, we don't want a cap, leave it alone. It limits the amount of time that your family can give you in home care to be compensated for that home care. And yet, there's studies that show that when family members give care at home, it's probably more meaningful in the long run than when you actually bring in the service, since it's a family member that's rendering the service, whatever it might be. Here's one that really doesn't make sense. There's a 52-week, this is in the new compromise legislation, 52-week on physical therapy, a limit. Well, if I were under that fund, I'm in my 19th, going on now 19 months, I'm still in a wheelchair, and I do therapy 3 days a week. So what happens to people like that who go through the year and they're still not fully recovered? Well, they're left to their own devices, they're left to their own, obviously their own pocketbook, and it's, you know, very expensive, and for people who have been involved in catastrophic accidents, it's long, long term. So it's arbitrary to put in a 52-week limit. The substitute bill that the insurance industry drafted would say passenger in your car who's not a Michigan resident is not covered. So if your relatives come in from out of state, they ride with you at their own risk. The MCCA, Michigan Catastrophic Claims Association, will still not open its books. I told you that before, when it makes these actuarial assumptions. And they're talking like I've seen Bolger's press releases on this. They talk about reforming the auto rates. We're talking about $186. That's what the auto no-fault is, $186. Is that going to make any difference to people in Detroit whose insurance is at $3,000, $4,000, $5,000? That's not where the real cost centers are. We know that. Say collision, theft, all the issues you have to insure against. And then make matters worse. He talks about cutting costs, and then it's a $25 fee in the new legislation to cover the gap in Medicaid. And that won't be there just for 1 year or 2 years. That's going to be a permanent tax that we're going to have to pay to cover the cost of Medicaid, which was expanded because of Obamacare. So I've just given you some of the highlights. So he's going to give you a 10% savings. For a couple of years, there's nobody in this room that doesn't believe that the auto industry, that's right, that the auto insurance companies will not raise their rates after that, you know, 2 year period is up. I think I've debated people in this before, and I have debated Peter Lund, one of the authors, and talking about it's hard to come out against a reform bill, because reform ranks right up there with motherhood and apple pie. Everybody's for reform, because it suggests something's broken and you're going to fix it. But in this instance, it's not broken. It's working the way it was designed. It's been called probably the best system in America by today. Some of our opponents have switched sides. And it's one man's reform is another man's death sentence. When people have taken off this kind of catastrophic care, Eventually have to go into their own pocket. Nobody can afford what the costs are for catastrophic care. So they'll go on Medicaid, and then the taxpayers pick up the bill instead of the insurance company. That's what this is all about, folks. Let's move it out of insurance over to Medicaid, and then the taxpayers can subsidize the care for those individuals. I've got other people who want to say something this morning, so let me go on. First, let me introduce some of the people who are here from some statewide associations. We have from the Brain Injury Association, which oftentimes is a byproduct of an accident like we're talking about. There's Mike Dabbs and Tom Constant. Why don't you guys raise your hand when I introduce you, okay? Mike and Tom. Chris Mitchell from the Michigan Health and Hospital Association. Natalie Lombardo and attorney Brandon Hewitt, who are from the Michigan Auto Law firm, opposing any change in the no-fault. The Coalition, you hear a lot about CPAN, the Coalition to Protect Auto No-Fault. There's John Prosser, John Karnak, Kevin McKinney are here. You've heard me mention Eric Olson. Eric was in an accident about 13 years ago now, and obviously was left as a quad, even though through tough recovery. Exercise here in her own studio. She's now sitting up in a chair like I have, making, I think, a miraculous recovery. She's an inspiration to people that in these kinds of accidents. She's Erica and her husband, Ira, are hosting us here this morning, and we appreciate that. This gives you an idea of what people who have been catastrophically injured, what they have to look forward to, this kind of therapy for the rest of their lives. Fred Nader, who is a Eric's father, he's a prominent businessman. He's really an excellent spokesperson for our side. I may have him come up here before the news conference is over. And Lisa, Mazzino?
Mazzio.
Thank you, Lisa. Mazzio from Advent Medical. And I see some legislators behind me. How are you, Phil? Why don't you introduce yourselves? Oh, no, Tundra will speak. Tim Stallworth, who's represents Detroit in the House and Ted of the Michigan Black Caucus, is going to speak because Mr. Duggan was able to make it this morning. Phil, I think I introduced you. Did I miss anybody else? Where's Gail? Oh, over there. Hi, Gail. I'm over here standing with the crowd. So with that, I'm delighted to have two of my colleagues here from the Big Four. I think Bob is going to go first. Bob Ficano, main kind of exec. And we'll bring up Mark Hackel. Once you get the flavor, it's not just a Republican, Brooks Patterson, who has a strong feelings. This cuts across politics. This gets right into how we treat some of the people in our society who are most vulnerable. Well, that about to come. Yeah, thanks, Bob.
Thank you. Very much, Brooks. I really have to admire Brooks for his passion and what he's done to carry on this issue and what he's been doing to continuously look at it and to continuously carry on the fight. I've had a number of experiences starting as Wayne County Sheriff for 20 years. You see a lot of accidents that occur on the road, and a lot of them at times get some media attention, and then subsequently, they could go on. You have victims for years, and people seem to forget about it and all that's involved with that person when they initially got in that accident, and the attention sort of melts away from it. And one of the concerns, obviously, has to do with trying to reform, or as Brooks said, to change the no-fault insurance law. I think many times, if you look across the nation of all 50 states, the Michigan no-fault has been one that has been proclaimed as really a model to be looked at, and one that the other states have tried to emulate or copy of what they've been able to do in passing a similar type of legislation. We're not here to demonize anybody today. I think everybody wants to just focus on facts and what they are and how we're going to be able to move forward. And is there possibilities of any compromise? Laws can always be tweaked or changed that, you know, can make a difference to help. I think at this particular time, from a Wayne County perspective, one of the concerns we do have is that we are self-insured. And what that means is we've seen the winter that we've had, we have 140 trucks that are out there with the snow plows and everything else. If the legislation was passed the way it is today, that once there was a cap that was reached, in theory then, Wayne County would have to pick up the cost of those individuals that would exceed the cap. And we've had an opinion from our corporation council. We originally looked at it when I believe it was $1 million that was the cap. Obviously now they've looked at $10 million as that is part of it. And so there is a concern about what happens from an insurance standpoint, from a practical standpoint of Wayne County, and if somebody unfortunately, tragically doing their job gets hurt, then this would shift the responsibility to the county and the taxpayers really to continue on to pick up the cost of what this is in this particular instance. I think that there's been, I know, a lot of discussion that goes back and forth on it. I know what the $10 million cap, I've heard that there are certain reforms that can be done without trying to cap the amount that that would be paid out under the legislation. And I think that the legislators on both sides are open to talking about it. I think they're always willing to talk about what we can do to make any law better at this particular time. One of the concerns I do have, though, is that we seem to be piecemealing at times looking at when we, quote, want to reform a system. I think one of the biggest challenges that we face in Wayne County is the insurance rates that we face overall, especially for the people in the city of Detroit. Many of you in the media here, I know, were at the State of the City, and you heard the mayor himself say that when he moved from where he was in the suburbs and when he moved to the city of Detroit, I believe his car insurance was $3,000. When he was in the suburbs, it jumped to like $6,000 when he moved into the city of Detroit. If we are really talking about real reform, I think we have to do that across the board and look at why does it cost so much more money to insure your car in the city of Detroit, and how come that's unfairly really being thrust upon the individuals that are in the city. So I think there's open for a lot of dialogue now that can happen and looking at totally what we can do to try to make the system better. Nobody is opposed to that, but there are a number of issues that I think that we're facing right now, especially with the additional costs that are really high insurance costs for Detroiters and getting car insurance. And it just leads to a number of different games that are played, anywhere from going out, getting the insurance, and immediately dropping it after a month and things like that. We want real reform that really helps people be able to get insurance, not try to encourage them to get around the law, but encourage them to engage with the law and for them to be able to protect their families. And from a county standpoint, we are concerned about the cap because it could impact the taxpayers of Wayne County once those caps are exceeded, because we'll probably have the liability or responsibility of picking up those additional costs, which somebody should do it, because no individual's life is considered too small not to have therapy and to have help them in what they need to get back to as good a quality of life as possible. I want to thank Walk the Line and meeting the owners and all that they've been able to do to really not only help push with the issue, but at the same time help so many people in what they've been able to do here. With that, I understand that Mark Hackel, the county executive from Macomb, is up next.
Thanks. Thanks, Bob, and thanks, Brooks. It's interesting because my being here was basically brought upon because of Brooks's interest in this issue. And obviously, he knows this issue, and he's been dealing with it for quite some time. And for me, this was something that wasn't even on my radar up until a couple of days ago when I got that call. And realizing that there is some kind of amendment or some legislation that's being proposed or put out there, I give Brooks a lot of credit for the reasons that sometimes he brings things to the public attention that otherwise go unnoticed. And that's exactly what's happening here. And even myself as an elected executive, this isn't something people in Macomb County have come to me saying, we need to make some changes or reforms when it comes to the auto insurance, and especially when we talk about no fault. And when I think about that, as Bob had mentioned, my experience in law enforcement over 30 years of seeing some of the tragedies that have occurred, people that weren't at fault in accidents, and some of the things that happen and the sustained injuries that they have to deal with, are something that really, I never got a lot of calls and people talking about. So when you talk about prioritization, if you think about it, here we're being held in a real high standard as far as how we deal with insurance and other states trying to figure out how do they model that for what we've got going. Yet at the very same time, We have got one of the worst road conditions in anywhere in the country, and that is a priority. And if you listen to the public, there isn't anywhere I go today, these past few months, that somebody isn't complaining about our road conditions. And we have probably the worst. We're number 50 in the entire country when it comes to reforms with our legislation to figure out how do we come up with funding for our roads. And here we're trying to change something that works, that has a lot of support from people, that I have had not one constituent in Macomb County talking about or complaining about. Yet every issue that I hear about deals with road funding. And so, you know, my reason for being here is really to kind of get out there and let the public realize, you know what, sometimes I think in Lansing, they need to start prioritizing what are the interests of the public and what is it they're concerned about and concerned about right now. And without question, it's road funding. So my objective is not only to learn more about or understand more about what is happening, because this is an issue to some and it's a concern to some, obviously, but really to get the legislators to start realizing we need to start prioritizing those conversations. If we're going to start reforming things, I think what they really need to be focusing 100% of their attention on is what we're doing with road funding so that people aren't getting into these accidents to begin with and seeing some of the tragedies that I have seen over 30 years and continue to see. So, again, I applaud Brooks on making this a public issue. Again, it's not to try to attack. It's an opportunity to bring about conversation that sometimes the public is unaware of. And this is somebody from the public who's an elected official that was really unaware of the real intricacies of this reform. And after listening, and I gotta believe everybody sitting here in this room, after you hear what he says and he kind of brings about some of the changes that are being talked about, you can't help but question, does that make sense? Why would we be doing that? And that's exactly what I'm gonna be doing, and I'm gonna be talking to our representatives in Macomb County and getting their understanding as to why is there a need for this change, and is there maybe some tweaking that could be done or better things that could be done with this legislation so that it's agreeable to all. But more importantly, where's the attention given to the reforms on dealing with funding for roads? That is my main concern right now. So thanks, Bruce.
Thanks, Mark. And Tommy Stalbert, the representative from the city of Trenton. Welcome. Thank you, Tommy.
Thank you, Brooks, and I want to thank all the people here who are here to advocate for fighting the proposed changes Representative Bolger have put forth. I'm Thomas Stallworth. I represent the 7th District in Detroit. I also chair the Michigan Legislative Black Caucus and the Detroit Caucus. Late last year, our Detroit caucus took a formal position of opposing auto no-fault reforms as put forth by Representative Bolger. What we're talking about today is merely a tweaking of the original proposal that we saw. I want to be clear that this isn't an issue, as we're talking about today, that we're willing to negotiate on. We're not interested in tweaking or modifying the proposal as put forth. Quite frankly, it is not addressing the issues that we care about and that citizens care about. I, too, am one of the citizens that pay $6,000 a year for auto no-fault insurance. And there are changes that can be made that will address those very, very expensive costs. The speaker and the special interest insurance groups have used words to like affordability, like transparency, all in a way in a disingenuous manner to attract the public's support. This is an inaccurate representation of what these bills what this bill will do. If in fact we're talking about affordability, we should be focusing on the 80% of the bill that actually drives the cost, whether that's collision and theft. There are opportunities to reduce costs based on real transparency. And let me be clear, this conversation started with a position that the auto no-fault system and the catastrophic fund was unsustainable. That's how this conversation started. Yet, that's not what the speaker is talking about now. He's talking about affordability and transparency and a lot of other things, but still going at the same issue and without ever proving the case. And so we've asked numerous times for the books to be open. If we really are vested and committed to transparency, then the MCCA should open their books. As Brooks mentioned earlier, we're talking about $18 billion. And let's just go on the record and say that part of the provision is that should a change be made and there is an excess in that fund, those excesses are shared by the insurance companies. And so our caucus members believe this is nothing more than an attempted train robbery, a hijacking of $18 billion by the auto insurance companies. And so again, we're not interested in negotiating on this specific set of bills. What we are interested in is putting in changes that will address the use of credit scoring, that will address the issues of transparency and regulations and oversight of the MCCA board so that all of our citizens and those who pay into the fund have an opportunity to see the numbers. That's a reasonable request. I think all of you would agree. And that's what real transparency is about. In many other states, insurance companies are required to go before a regulatory board to prove their case to increase rates. We don't have such oversight here in Michigan. And Speaker Bolger has offered $160, $180, 10% reduction in rates that he's willing to only guarantee for 2 years. And then the position is, after that 2 years, competition will take over. Well, isn't that what we got right now? Competition? I don't think that $160 that he's proposed will be retained. I believe the rates will jump right back up and we will get absolutely no benefit. Quite frankly, $160 is an insult to somebody who's paying $6,000 for auto insurance. It goes nowhere near addressing the issues that we have. And so I again want to just emphasize that there are changes that can be made that the Republican caucus, some of them, and I need to, in saying that, say I really am thankful to my counterpart on the other side of the aisle, Gail Haynes, who has been a real champion for effective changes that really meet the needs of the citizens of Michigan. I also want to thank Phil Kavanaugh, who has, in our Detroit caucus, really been a driver of proposals and recommendations that will make real changes to our system that will drive down affordability and drive transparency. And so there are opportunities to make changes that you'll be hearing more about from us in the very, very near future. But again, I think in closing, I just want to be clear that we have said from the very beginning, if the issue is sustainability of the MCCA fund, the only way we can even have a conversation about the fund is first open the books. We need to know what the profits are. We need to see the actuarial forecast. We need to be clear that the fund is truly at risk. And I can only submit to you that the unwillingness to do so would suggest to me that the fund is really not seeing a crisis, that in fact it is sustainable, and everything we're talking about is a smokescreen aimed at garnering the fund, that $18 billion that sits in the fund. So with that, I also want to say to you that my first real exposure to this issue came with my visit right here. And when I came here, I had the opportunity to meet and talk with citizens who were the victims of catastrophic injuries and who had been told they would never walk again. Institutions like this give them hope, give them the therapy that they need to have a brighter future and an opportunity to regain their independence. What Speaker Bolger's proposal will do ultimately is drive those same people into bankruptcy and into on nursing homes only to die when we have a system that really is put together in a way that treats the victims of catastrophic injuries as real people who ought to be cared for and are deserving of the attention they currently receive. And so I want to thank Walk the Line, Erica, Red Nader, for their commitment to service and helping those who are truly in need. And we stand together opposed to the current legislation. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tommy. And when I grew up in politics, I won't be able to have the same level of passion in, that you have for that. I appreciate your remarks. Fred, I know you have an interest in Erica's father, been very instrumental in the fight, and so I've talked to you before. You probably know some of the nuances of this legislation that bother you.
Well, thank you, Brooks, and I want to thank everybody for being here today, especially Representative Gail Haynes, all of our esteemed CEOs from the Tri-County area, and of course, Representative Stallworth and Representative Kavanaugh. My name is Fred Nader, better known as Erica's dad, but I work in the auto industry, and I'm the president of Auto Tech Technology Development, and recently was given the assignment by Brooks to head up a connected car initiative in Oakland County. Now, this is a pathway to autonomous driving eventually, but what's really important and how it ties in with this issue is that over the next 5 to 10 years, you're going to hear a lot, not only hear a lot about connected car throughout the country, but over that time period, it's going to become ubiquitous throughout the country. And according to all of the car companies and the Department of Transportation, it's going to reduce auto accidents by 73%. So, you know, reductions of car accidents and catastrophic injuries are coming as a result of technology. With respect to this bill, I just think that this bill, as a citizen and as an individual and a parent of somebody who's catastrophically injured, this bill is just an embarrassment. It does nothing to address the fact that Michigan has no laws on the books for consumer protection over auto insurance. It says nothing about complete transparency, and I agree with Representative Stallworth and Brooke. That's the foundation. We can't tweak this bill. This bill is a train wreck, and this bill is not possible to be tweaked. What we need to have legislation put in place that will implement real consumer protection laws that will stop the insurance company from gouging people in the city of Detroit and other places. And we need to understand what the real driving forces are behind auto insurance. We don't have that in Michigan. And then we need complete transparency over the MCCA. And to me, you know, offering this bill with a 10% reduction, $10 a month reduction in your auto insurance costs, which is about what it costs, what the savings would be, and then adding a $25 tax on Medicaid, geez, it's like you're robbed. I get robbed on a train of $100 and the robber gets caught and he gets told, well, God, give him back 10 bucks and everything will be okay. No, this is wrong. This is wrong, and we need to stay united and fight against it. And I think, as you see, this is not a Democrat issue. It's not a Republican issue. It's a people issue. And we've got people on both sides of the aisle united now in fighting against these changes. Thank you.
My name is Dr. Owen Perlman. I'm from Ann Arbor, Michigan at St. Joseph Mercy Hospital, a board member of the Brain Injury Association of Michigan. As a physiatrist, I take care of patients that have catastrophic injuries, brain injuries and spinal cord injuries in particular. I wanted to take a couple of minutes to piggyback on what you've heard without repeating it, focusing a little bit more on what goes on as opposed to the bill itself, so that you have a framework to understand why the information we've heard from each of these individuals is so important. The first thing I do is want to thank Erica for hosting us today as well. If you watched the Academy Awards last night, 12 Years a Slave was the best picture. When Steve McQueen got up to accept the award, he made a statement. He said, the goal is not just to survive, but to live. And the goal of somebody who sustained a catastrophic injury is not just to survive, but to live. Not just to get through the first 52 weeks or the first 104 weeks, but to live the rest of their lives. I've been doing this for 35 years. I have patients that I followed for at least 34 years, many that I followed for well more than 20 years. And they're all trying to live, and they're trying to contribute to society, just as we've seen Erica do. As we look around at a facility like Walk the Line, it's important to recognize that this is from the bottom up, meaning that this is not from insurance companies developing a facility like Walk the Line. This is not from health insurance companies developing a facility like this. This is from people that have sustained injuries, putting their hard-earned money down to develop facilities like this because they recognize that there is a very important need to continue treatment well beyond 52 weeks and 104 weeks. So it's important to recognize that spinal cord injury and traumatic brain injury are chronic diseases, no different than diabetes, hypertension, kidney disease, that are going to affect a person for the rest of their lives. And as they get older, they're going to be at risk for other medical conditions that are going to come as a result of it. People will say that the cap is very high, it's $10 million. In other states, the cap is only $50,000. So why is there a concern? Because in the other states, people that are injured have to sue to get their benefits. They might get benefits of $1 million, $5 million, $10 million, but while they're waiting to get those benefits, they're not getting any treatment. They're waiting 1 or 2 years to begin their treatment after that $50,000 has run out. When we talk about shifting people to Medicaid, it's meaningless in the sense that Medicaid doesn't cover anything. So you're shifting them to something that doesn't really exist. It might give them a modicum of health care, but it's not going to allow them to continue with therapy. It's not going to allow them to modify their homes to be accessible for them, to modify vehicles to be accessible for them to get out into the community, to participate with families and to do the things that they want to do that they were able to do before. They won't have case management services. There wouldn't be residential services. There wouldn't be, to be honest about it, good vocational services. And so the shift that we talk about, it's not as if it's just a shift from the private sector to the public sector. It's a shift to the public sector that can't do anything about it. They can't help these individuals. When the insurance companies want to talk, or the legislators want to talk about problems that need to be resolved, as I look around the room, many of you own your own businesses. If you have a problem in your business, you take a quality assurance or quality improvement approach to it. You analyze the problem. You get the data. You try to determine what's going on. You develop a hypothesis. You test it. And then you implement a change. And then you monitor it. Thus far, the way this bill is presented, it's simply taking a look at what they've paid out in terms of cost to providers. There's no analysis of rate making, of profit, et cetera. And so when we've talked about rate making as it relates to the MCCA, so I'm not going to get further into MCCA transparency, but hospitals, and we all rely on hospitals in every community throughout our state, hospitals in a good year have a profit of 2 to 3%. And that's in a good year. I think you just saw in the headlines last week, Beaumont Hospital looking at layoffs, looking for a merger partner. Beaumont is an excellent hospital with a tremendous reputation. It's a pillar of Oakland County. And if they're in trouble, as it is right now, you can imagine what it would be like if all of a sudden there was managed care or rate setting or fee schedules under those circumstances. Insurance companies allegedly, because I don't have their books, allegedly have a profit of 20, 22%. Hospitals have a profit of 2%. You can do the math yourself and understand where things stand under that regard. Managed care, which is one of the proposals in this bill, hasn't worked for health insurance as it is, which is why most people have opted against it or into PPOs, professional provider organizations, because managed care limits where you can be treated. You know, people want to have the ability to go to different places around the state, to move around the state as well. Fee schedules, particularly when they talk about workers' compensation, Workers' compensation is 100 years old in the state of Michigan. Fee schedules didn't come to workers' compensation in the state of Michigan until the 70s or the 80s, when there was a concern about losing our manufacturing base in the state of Michigan to surrounding states, because there was concern about a loss of business or the inability to attract business. That's why fee schedules came up in Michigan. The insurance companies are not running to neighboring states. Nobody's running to leave the state because they can't make a profit in Michigan. They can make an excellent profit in Michigan. It's not as if they need the relief under those circumstances. If affordability is an issue, then we should be taking a look at what their rate making is and what their profits are. I think it's very important just to recognize, as I think maybe Tommy Stallworth said, or maybe Brooks said, that this is something that seems to be coming from the top down, not from the bottom up. There's not a single individual or a single individual whose family has been hit by someone with a catastrophic injury who would support this. There's probably not anybody in the medical field who would support this as well. There's not anybody who, with any feeling, who would support this as well. So I just wanted to share that.
Thank you for being here. My name is Erica Colston. I was injured in a car accident in Michigan in 2001. And one point that I would like to speak to that has often been brought up about this issue is, what do people in other states do? And I've been to other states, I have friends that are from other states, and it's not a good situation. I don't even think you have to go to another state to ask, what do other people do that don't have the same quality of care that's provided through our auto no-fault system? Unfortunately, people that have even Medicare or traditional Blue Cross insurance, not even speaking to Medicaid, oftentimes have very little to no in-home attendant care provided, which means that their family members have to quit their jobs and stay home and work to take care of them, or they end up in a nursing home. Very little, if any, physical therapy, speech therapy, occupational therapy, any of it. Medicare's therapy cap per year is $3,400. There's so many, I hesitate to call them benefits. There's so many aspects of care when it comes to catastrophic injuries that are not addressed in the traditional health system. So that would be my main point. Thank you.
Thank you, Erica. Now, ladies and gentlemen from the media, I think any of the speakers that you just heard will not take questions. Pardon me? Somebody? I'll tell you what we will do, since there's no question coming from the media. If you want to talk to any one of these individuals who spoke, please do so at this time. And thank you all for coming out. That's such an important subject for so many people, and this legislation is just, it is cruel. It really is cruel. Thank you.